I think he's ready to crack.
Of course he's ready to crack.
Yeah, but keep the pressure up.
Again, Malcolm.
I already told you.
Let's hear it again, Malcolm.
I don't remember.
Would you like a cigarette, Malcolm?
Now I remember. I don't smoke. Could I have a glass of water?
Got a light.
Don't you see the no smoking sign?
No, I didn't see it.
All right, Malcolm. Go ahead.
It was a day. Any other day.
Hey, Chief, I don't see the no smoking sign either.
It was a day like any other day.
We'll go raise the shade.
Okay.
It was a day like any other day.
Let's hear the whole story.
It was a day like any other day. How did I know it would end up the way it did? He was lying there on the floor, his feet looking like they could use a walk. But there was one thing missing. He wasn't breathing.
Well, Roy,
the bullet hole in the window was the first tip-off. And then it was on the skids from there until he went down for the last pulse beat.
I don't see it on any of the walls.
He was dead.
So keep looking.
We both knew it. But I was the only one left alive to remember. It was all a mystery.
What was that, Malcolm?
That's why I got into
it. What was that, Malcolm?
It was a day like any other day.
No, Malcolm.
It was a
day. Start from the beginning. First, your name.
Malcolm.
Your occupation?
Poultry engineer. Self-employed.
Now. Tell a story in your very own words.
Chief?
It all began this morning.
Maybe
there's
no
way
back.
Anyone could predict
well,
that anything like
be,
this
my
could
friend.
Ever happen in our time.
If somebody stolen our nose.
I never imagined that anything like this could ever happen to me in a short 7 hours. But it did. It was a morning like any other day. Morning like any other morning. And just a short 7 hours ago when it all began. Or was it 3 years? I just don't remember anymore. It just started, and I was there. A lousy 7 hours to strip the thin veneer off a town. A small town. 120 people tops. Maybe that's why it fell on me. To crack open the deadly riddle of the Manchu ego. But 420 minutes ago, it was all in the cards. That's when I woke up.
Vivacious personality.
Oh, I admit you are more vivacious than anyone on television. Precious heart.
Oh, I'm really going to have to start my limbering up exercises in the morning. As soon as the pain in my side is better.
Ida May, maybe you should get up and move around the trailer a little.
Are you forgetting what Dr. Simpson said about being careful after an appendectomy?
Well, your appendectomy was 8 months ago.
See, you never take into consideration my exhaustion. Now, Dr. Simpson is far, far too tactful to say anything. If he knew the hell I had to live through every day, he'd understand. But I'll never tell him. I'll never tell anyone. The nightmare of our marriage will never be known outside this trailer.
Ida May, believe me, I think you've been a terrific sport about this whole thing. And I haven't forgotten my promise to make it big. Right now, Ida May, at this very moment, I'm on the brink of something that's real big.
Malcolm, I want to believe in you.
Well, that's why I didn't want to tell you till I was absolutely sure. Because, well, I didn't want you to think it was just another failure. Well, Ida May, you know Easter is coming.
I know. They preempt all the good shows.
They sell a lot of eggs at Easter. And I have been experimenting with several hens to lay colored eggs. You know Ellen, the big leghorn? Well, we've programmed her to lay the jumbo triple A egg with a scene of the resurrection inside.
You can't get a chicken to do that, where you look inside the egg and all.
But we've already done it. Ellen's laid three of the large eggs already. But we haven't. You see, she hasn't got the resurrection scene quite right yet. Jesus keeps coming out with feathers and a split beak.
Malcolm, I am a person. I'm a human being. I have my needs. I will not live through any more of you and your ridiculous schemes. I'm so tired.
Maybe you should take a little nap, huh?
Yes, I think I will doze off a bit.
Dr. Mellon, would you believe it? Dr. Mellon? Dr. Mellon, wake up. Please. Dr. Mellon, please stay awake. Oh, Roy? Malcolm at the hatchery, US 24. Roy, a speeder just ran over one of my chickens. Yeah. Dr. Mellon, would you please wake up? Now, Roy, no, we didn't get the license number. There were no witnesses. Now, Roy, you tell the chief that you people have got to start doing something about this. Well, it's the fourth hit-and-run chicken I've had this month. Roy, I'm telling you that there's a breakdown in law and order, Roy, don't hang up on me. Roy? My infection clearing up rapidly. Very good. Lillian looks sick. Oh, my goodness. Look at those feathers. Lillian, are you all right? Now, let me see the feathers. Hey, Dr. Mellon, she's beginning to look like a falcon. I'll tell you what we better do. I'll give her 20 cc's of corn concentrate and change the straw. You got that?
Yes, good.
Now,
who's Lillian?
Who is Lillian? Lillian is a chicken. This chicken, our prime test case. The jumbo six yolk egg, have you forgotten that too?
I can't remember if I have or I haven't.
I'll get it.
Get a home. Go in a couple of rooms. Go in.
Oscar. What are you doing here?
I need a private detective.
Follow me.
What is it, Oscar?
Flyer that I got in the mail. Mm-hmm. That is your flyer, isn't it?
Of course it's mine. You don't think I sent out a flyer that wasn't mine, do you? Oscar, I see you're in some sort of trouble, so you being my first client, I'm going to give you the introductory gift discount and a warranty good up to and including 90 days.
Malcolm, are you qualified to be a private eye?
Am I qualified, if I may? Just step back a little. I happen to be a recent graduate of the famous detective school, Battle Creek, Michigan. Notice the initials signed by the late former Major General Mark Stanton, Coast Guard Auxiliary, Reserve, retired.
Yeah, they misspelled your name. It says Malcolm.
Yes, I noticed that after I'd paid for the course, but they'll be making amends in a couple of weeks.
Okay, look, I'm desperate. I'll settle for your help. Anything, Malcolm.
Have a seat.
Thank you.
Now, Oscar, it is necessary that we begin our relationship with mutual trust and confidence. So now, if you will just sit back and relax and tell me your problem in your own words.
Someone is trying to kill me.
Who would want to kill Oscar Cornell?
Now, do you believe me? What was that?
There is a perfectly logical explanation for that. Probably a prank by some kid. Small rock thrown at a very high velocity.
Are you sure?
All right. I'll double check for you.
They tried last night, too.
But who, Oscar? Who would want to kill you?
I think Big Daddy Jessup's trying to kill me.
Well, why would he want to kill you? He's rich.
He doesn't want me to see his daughter anymore. He's threatened me twice already.
Well, why would you want to see his daughter? No one in town has ever seen her. He's kept her hidden for years.
I saw her. But look, I don't want my wife to know about any of this. You understand? Nothing.
I understand.
I mean, sure, I've got a successful milk route, but career isn't everything.
Is that one of my chicks?
Yeah, I picked it up outside while I was waiting for you. Hope you don't mind.
Oh, no, of course. In fact, you could have it if you like. I recall you mentioning something about Big Daddy's daughter.
Oh, yeah. I couldn't believe it, Malcolm. She was so...
Was she looking?
Well, there was something special.
Did she go all the way?
Malcolm, she understood me the way no one ever did before. I remember one time she looked at me and she said, Oscar.
Thank you.
Oscar. Oscar, can you hear me? Oscar, can you hear me? Nod your head. One for yes, two for no. Oscar!
Dr. Mellon.
What is it, Mellon?
I want you to examine this man.
What seems to be the problem?
I think he's dead.
Well, his heart stopped beating. Oh, was this his arrow?
No, it came separately.
Well, I don't think we can rule it out as the cause of death.
Now look, Doctor, I don't want you to breathe a word of this to anybody. Do you understand? It's top secret.
Well, you'll have to tell the police.
Police? Never. If a word of this ever leaked out, it would ruin my career. Now, do you understand?
Understand what?
Don't touch anything. I knew I'd gotten off on the wrong foot with this case. Oscar was killed even before we could discuss my fee. But I was going to follow through. As far as I was concerned, he was still my client, hot or cold. As things stood, he was getting colder by the minute. That meant I didn't have much time to find his killer. Maybe if he'd come to me sooner, this wouldn't have been the fade out for him. His life was a puzzle, all right. But he wouldn't be around to sort out the pieces. And there was a lot to sort out, including Big Daddy Jessup, the richest man in town, and his daughter. There was another attempt on him last night. I figured there had to be a connection.
And soap.
All right, I want you to take charge of this. Put it back in the wagon. I want you to impound that end table and the lamp. We can use them in the office.
Check.
What about that television set? Black and white. Oh, what are you doing here, Malcolm?
Oh, just curious, Chief. So your car parked outside. What's going on?
Oh, we're just taking some evidence down to headquarters. Oh, Roy, I want you to get the camera and take a few pictures of the victim.
Check.
What is it, Chief? Murder?
That's for the medical boys to decide.
But you don't have any medical boys.
That's what makes these cases so difficult. I'm supposed to do everything. I don't. Roy is incompetent.
Chief, who's the victim?
Go see for yourself.
I don't get it.
You don't get what, Malcolm?
Goat wearing pajamas, nylon stocking around his neck. Who would want to kill an animal dressed like that?
It's a prank by some kids.
Who checked into this room last night?
Well, we haven't gone into the case that deep, and besides, I don't think it's really that important.
Well, have you ever considered that this might be something more than just a childish prank?
No. Roy, will you stop wasting those bulbs? Call a rendering truck, have them come out here and pick up this victim.
Chief.
Huh?
Don't you think that the circumstances suggest something, shall we say, a bit, unusual?
Malcolm,
I know all about those private detective courses you're taking. I run a tap on everybody's mail. And I don't want to see you get carried away with any sudden idea of unorthodox murder.
Chief, can I talk to you as one investigator to another?
I'm busy dusting for prints.
All right, now, Chief, listen to this. Now, suppose the victim wasn't placed there later. Suppose the animal checked into the room with the victim and was killed by mistake by someone who wanted to kill the guest.
Well, why would anybody want to come here with a goat?
Possibly to use as a decoy.
That is the funniest idea I ever heard in my life. Ever. Now, get out of the way, will you? And you want to know what really happened? Well, it's obvious. Some kids got in here after the football game last night over in Oswego. And they brought their mascot here with them, see? Mm-hmm. Now, they were drinking a little beer and smoking a little bit. And they killed their own mascot while under the influence. I think that the mascot OD'd.
Overdosed? What? Did you find needle marks on the leg?
No, couldn't tell. There's too much hair. But it's an open and shut case, you know. Damn junkies. What is this country coming to?
Chief?
What took you so long?
Somebody must have stole those yellow forms out of the car.
Oh, damn. What about the rendering truck?
Phil ain't home. His boy said he took the truck and went to a barbecue.
Double damn. Well, we'll have to put the victim up on top of the station wagon and dump him off someplace by the side of the road. All right, Malcolm.
Huh?
Get lost.
Good luck to you, Chief.
Roy, get a sheet for the victim.
I knew it was time for me to make an official visit to Big Daddy Jessup. Big Daddy was the most feared and respected man in town. He had money and power. He was cold-blooded and dangerous. Besides that, he was one of my hatchery's biggest customers. I couldn't be certain, but the car looked vaguely familiar. This time I was asking the questions, but I wasn't answering. Not just yet. I decided to give the grounds a fast once-over, which meant I had to look around for myself.
Hi, Freddy.
Hello, stupid.
Is your father at home?
Who wants to see him?
I do.
You got an appointment?
No.
Well, then what do you want, jerk?
Well, I was wondering if you could stop spitting on my shoes.
I'm sorry, meathead. I was only trying to get that cockroach in your cuff.
Where's Big Daddy?
We don't need any more eggs, dummy.
Look, Freddy. Freddy, I'll take it up with your father if you don't mind.
You want to see him? He's out in the back 40. But it better be important. You bug my old man, and he'll put you out of business tomorrow.
You've never really liked me, have you, Freddy?
I just think you're an ineffectual clod.
Well, let me give you a little warning, son. I don't care whose boy you are. Don't get insulting.
I could never really warm up to Freddy. I knew he was just a high-spirited kid, but he could get to be a real pain.
Well! Come on there. One more time. Come on, Philip. All right, now.
Big Daddy.
Oh! Paul, Philip!
May I have a conference with you?
Paul, Philip!
Big Daddy.
What do you want, Malcolm?
Well, I realize that I'm here.
Malcolm, I'll pay your bill when I'm damn good and ready.
No,
come on,
it's not the bill.
Come on, boy, you can do it. Come on, Philip. Paul!
Afternoon to discuss
Malcolm,
this matter with you.
I think I know why you really came to see me. I received your private eye flyer in the mail. I want you to know that you're hired.
Hired? To do what?
My daughter, Olivia, I think she's been seeing a man on the sly. You may have heard that I keep her sheltered away for her own protection. She's a very shy, sensitive, fragile girl. She's very easily hurt.
I hear you keep her locked in a barn.
I know. There's a lot of loose talk about that.
Is it true?
Of course. That's why there's loose talk. And I want it stopped. Because it's not really a barn. It's sort of done up like an apartment. I keep her there so she won't stray off. And for good reason. I stayed up with her the last few nights because she talks in her sleep. Sure enough, she revealed that there was someone.
Did she say who it was?
Only his nickname. Clyde Beatty.
I think I've heard that name somewhere before.
Find him.
I wouldn't have hurried back to the office if I'd known what was waiting for me. Jasmine.
Malcolm.
What can I do for you?
I got your private detective flyer in the mail. I need your help. Oscar's gone. Missing.
Well, I have ways of finding him.
Oh. Malcolm. You're so kind. Thank you.
Jasmine, would you care to sit down? Jasmine, when did you first discover that Oscar was missing?
2 days ago. He left on his milk route and he never came back.
Any idea why?
Oh, yes, but...
Oh, now, Jasmine, you must put your trust in me.
Well, everyone in town thought we were an ideal couple. Everyone. But it just isn't true.
Well, what is the truth, Jasmine?
The truth is, we've been married 12 years, and in all that time, he never once touched me.
He never engaged in marital relations?
Never.
Would you say then that your marriage wasn't normal?
No, not according to everything I've read, no.
Jasmine, would you consider that Oscar could be involved with another woman?
Was always so withdrawn, so unsure of himself. No. But you know, a terrible thing happened just before our marriage. He was dismissed from veterinary school.
Why was he dismissed?
On his discharge, it just said it couldn't stand the smell.
Oscar had a deep-seated hatred for animals.
Oh, no. No. He loved animals. He was always bringing home a stray dog, a stray horse, a stray sheep.
A goat?
Everything. He even wanted to bring home large birds. He had this thing about one particular bird. The Manchu eagle. He said his mother used to tell him stories about it when he was a child to try and put him to sleep.
Very interesting behavioral pattern. Oscar went to sleep hearing about this bird every night.
No! Every afternoon. You see, his mother was an infomaniac, and his father was an army deserter, so she was alone for years. And naturally, she tried to put little Oscar, which is what she called him then, she tried to put little Oscar to sleep when her gentleman callers would drop by after lunch. But, of course, Oscar wasn't really tired, so she would tell him these bird stories, and then she drugged him. Yes, even years later, when he found out the truth about his mother when she was killed by a road gang. He never gave up on this bird.
I never heard of any Manchu eagle.
It doesn't exist. There is no such creature. I looked it up. But for the sake of my marriage to Oscar, I played along with the idea. But I would not allow him to bring any animals or birds into the house. That's where I drew the line. I'm very allergic.
Jasmine, did you find that his attention to animals put a strain on your marriage?
Oh, it's so warm. Do you mind if I take off my jacket?
Well, I could open the window.
Oh, no. I might get a summer chill.
Now, what did you do to try to remedy this marital situation?
Well, I did arrange for him to go to a sex clinic in St. Louis.
Uh-huh. So Oscar went to Masters and Johnson, huh?
No, Barnum and Bailey. He changed the reservation.
Can I help you, Jasmine? Why did Oscar go to Barnum and Bailey?
I'm not sure. But the letters that he sent during the 6 months he was there spoke of his fondness for creatures. And he hoped that it would open up his feelings so he could love me more.
What was your relationship with Oscar after he returned?
Desperate.
Did you consummate your marriage?
Never. I really can't talk about it.
Isn't it true that you really hated Oscar? You hated him and everything he didn't stand for.
Well, that's not true.
Did you once say that you wished he were dead?
Oh, no.
Never?
Well, I did say it once, but I was just annoyed. He came back from a milk delivery, and there was cud all over him.
Do you have any insurance on Oscar?
Oh, yes, I had a $100,000 missing persons policy.
A double indemnity?
Yes, but the money isn't important. Will you take my case?
You know I've always been fond of you and Oscar. Of course, I'll take the case, and for free. Unless, of course, the insurance company pays off, then I want 65% of the action.
I'll do anything you say, Mel. Welcome. I'm a married woman.
I wasn't sure what a game was. But she was certainly worth watching. I had to be careful, though. She seemed sincere, but the concerned wife act could be just a way to throw suspicion away from herself.
Be sure and drop by if anything else happens to come up.
Person in this town that makes any sense.
Everybody needs somebody.
But this case, Bert, it's got so many missing pieces.
Caught between the devil and the deep blue sea.
And that's where I'm at.
You've got to crawl before you run.
I've got everything riding on this one, Bert.
You can't put all your eggs in one basket, Malcolm.
Hello, Winston. Come here. Come here, Winston. Probably one of the greatest truffle hunters in the territory. Till he lost interest.
Win some, lose some.
But he's still got a great nose.
Man's best friend.
Bert, thanks for the advice. See you later.
Malcolm? You lost the battle, but not the war.
The circle was getting smaller. First Oscar, then Jasmine, now Big Daddy. I was just into it. Already I had three clients, one dead and two marked bill me later. It all came down to one thing. I had to see Big Daddy's daughter.
Come on out, let me get a look at you. I know you're in here.
And hope that your success will fulfill them. You have dreams unrealized, but fear that there is little time left for you to achieve them.
Introduce myself. I'm a private investigator. But you can call me Malcolm if
you bring me a present?
Oh, well, I'm sorry. I didn't,
Do you know my daddy?
Well, that's one of the things I wanted to talk to you about. You see, I'm an accredited investigator, and I've been...
Daddy always brings me a present in his pocket.
Then
I give him a big hug. You have a vision of yourself that no one else can understand. People around you sense your inner strength and are jealous of you. Those closest to you cannot see your genius.
Are you sure you don't mind if I ask you a few questions?
About what?
Oscar Cornell. Look, Olivia, I must know. When was the last time you saw Oscar?
He borrowed Susan and didn't bring her back 2 days ago.
Who's Susan?
Daddy gave Susan to me when she was just a baby kid. And she grew and became a smelly old goat.
Did you ever sit in Oscar's lap?
No, but Susan did. Then Oscar would bring me books and read to me. And he told me stories about the Manchu eagle.
What did he tell you about the Manchu eagle?
Just that it was the most beautiful, loving bird in the whole world.
Did you see it? Did you actually see the Manchu eagle?
Did Oscar have one with him?
No, he told me that there's a whole world outside this barn, Olivia. But Daddy says it's a bad place.
I took a big chance in coming here, but I took the risk because I wanted to find out the truth.
I won't tell if you bring me something next time.
Off the door.
Freddy must have taken it off.
Huh. Who were you talking to just now?
I was talking to my daddy, but he wasn't here, so I had to pretend.
Oh. Come here, sweetheart.
You have
have a vision of yourself that no one else can understand. People around you sense your inner strength, and they're jealous of you. Oh, Daddy.
Time was working against me. I suppose it wasn't really Oscar's fault, but every turn had led me to a dead end. I still had a few good turns left in me, but nowhere to do them. If only he could talk, then maybe he could give me some clue to putting together the puzzle he dropped on me. Dr. Mellon.
Oh, there you are, Malcolm.
I want you to take a look at this envelope.
To H. Fredericks. Mm-hmm. Well, it certainly isn't for me.
I found this on Oscar's body. Now, this may be a valuable piece of evidence, a valuable clue.
Strong masculine hand. Mm-hmm. Well, we could run it through the spectrograph.
Could do that.
Or run the name through cryptanalysis.
Mm-hmm.
Or we could open the envelope and examine the contents.
To my darling Helen, forgive me if you can, Oscar. To my H. Fredericks, darling Helen.
Helen.
Oscar. Oscar Fredericks.
Helen.
Darling Helen Fredericks.
Helen Fredericks. Helen Fredericks.
Helen,
of course, Helen Fredericks. It's a definite possibility. I'll look it up in the phone book.
I couldn't believe that she would be involved with Oscar. But it had to be her. The matchup of names was too close to be a coincidence.
Miss Fredericks, I'd like to talk to you.
What do you want, Malcolm? Certainly hope it isn't about that tasteless detective flyer you sent me. I really can't talk to you now. I have a lot of papers to correct.
Jasmine Cornell has hired me to find a missing husband.
Oscar's missing.
So you do know Oscar Cornell?
Well, certainly everyone knows Oscar. He's a wonderful milk deliverer.
Perhaps you can explain this, little love note I found.
Is it really from Oscar?
Well, it's addressed to you, isn't it, H. Fredericks? Darling Helen?
Leave me alone. Please, go away, Dr. Rose.
Let's talk it over inside, quietly.
No, you'll have to go.
What are you hiding in there?
Nothing.
You made that noose?
Yes. I'm a scout mistress. You know that, Malcolm. You all right?
I left the oven on. At first, I thought it might be just a leak. Did you leave this pillow in the oven?
What? This?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I don't know. I guess the cat must have dragged it in here while I was teaching.
These your sleeping pills?
I confiscated those off a fourth grade pupil. I forget his name. Do you remember Bart Phillips? He was nodding off during nutrition period.
Look, Miss Fredericks, let's be truthful with one another.
Miss Fredericks!
Miss Fredericks.
No.
Have you been despondent over anything lately?
I'm so ashamed.
Now, you listen to me. Suicide is nothing to be ashamed of. Well, look, I happen to be a confidential investigator. You can talk to me.
I always buy these by the case. It's much cheaper. So, I think that a little cocktail after a long day at school is very relaxing. Resuscitating. Sure you wouldn't like a little something?
Mm-hmm. No way. Miss Fredericks.
Yes.
Miss Fredericks. How deeply were you involved with Oscar?
Oscar said he found the moon, the stars, and the trees all in my eyes.
Did he ever bring any animals around the house?
Yeah, Oscar was very fond of animals, especially of my cat. My cat, Rhoda. He took Rhoda everywhere, almost into the bathroom. He said there were mice in there, but Lord knows I never saw any. Once he brought a cow, and then one day he brought a caribou. He was always finding animals in the preserve, you see.
But was there anything out of the ordinary in his behavior?
Yes, he always wanted me to pet them. And then he'd do strange things. The day he brought the cow over, he jumped on the cow and he asked me to kiss it. But I didn't do it.
Any other animals?
Oh, lots of small animals, bunnies, things like that. We would play with them in the living room after dinner, and then he'd put them in his jacket and leave. I don't know why I'm telling you all this. But one day the suitcase fell open, and it was full of clothes, lots of little babies' bonnets and
did you notice a light blue pajama top with lace around the sleeves?
No, but there were two chemises and a bridal veil, and I went to him. Well, I thought for a moment they were for me, so I went to him and I said, Oscar, what are these for? And he asked me to put them on Bossy.
Did you comply with this unusual request?
Yes, I did. And then Oscar got the strangest look in his eyes. He started to jump up and down, and he got red in the face, and then suddenly he fell over in a swoon. I remember one day he put one of his bonnets on that goose outside, and he started petting the goose's head, and I held out my hands, and I said, Oscar, pet me, Oscar. He kept petting the goose.
The last time you saw Oscar, was he here with the goat?
She was the last straw.
Did she answer to the name of Susan?
That's her. The bitch.
Did he ever mention a certain Manchu eagle?
Yes, how did you know that? Oscar felt that the Manchu eagle was the most wonderful bird in the world. I was never sure how he got such an idea, but he wanted one very badly. I knew there was no such bird, and that last terrible day, I was so angry. Well, I know I should never have said anything, but I told him there was no such bird as a Manchu eagle. He looked at me with this funny hurt look, and his mouth moved, but there was no sound. And his eyes filled with tears as if he was going to cry. And then He picked up the goat and left. Oh, God, I wish I was dead.
I didn't know if the tears were for my benefit, but she certainly had a classic motive, revenge.
I don't see what's so difficult about it. From what you told me, it seems obvious that Oscar Cornell was some kind of freak, and he got himself murdered by that little sadist, Freddie Jessup.
I happen to be a professional investigator, and I've been sifting through every fact, every detail. I have analyzed every suspect, every clue, every conceivable motive. And I tell you, Ida May, I don't know any more now than I did when I started.
I believe you.
Then how can you just lie there and make such snap judgments?
I'm just so tired.
Ida May, you're my wife and I love you. But you've got to face up to certain definite facts. I have a vision of myself that you don't understand. But then again, sometimes those closest to you cannot see your genius. But I don't blame you, Ida May. It's just that you just don't know me at all. I've got to go now. Time's running short. Bert, I tell you, this case has almost got me licked.
That's the way it goes.
I've been on it all day. The clock is running out on me.
Time's money.
I don't know who to believe at this point.
You can't judge a book by its cover.
I don't know whether I'll be able to pull this case off, Bert.
It's always darkest before dawn.
If I blow this one, I lose everything.
You can't keep a good man down.
Bert, I get the message.
Then let a smile be your umbrella.
Laugh, and the world laughs with you.
Money can't buy happiness.
That's what friends are for.
And it takes one to know one.
Bert, thank you. I'll see you later.
Malcolm?
Yeah?
It's a small world.
There was only one man left to turn to, Dr. Simpson.
Now, Malcolm, I want you to know that I can help you solve your sexual problems. You take two of these pills every 20 minutes for the next 2 months. And if you notice any abnormal swelling, let me know and I will inform the company. I'm doing a little clinical research for them, picking up a little spare pocket money on the side, you understand?
Doctor, Well, I'm not here for treatment.
Oh, you're not?
No.
Well, now, that's what I like about you, Malcolm. You're never sick. You don't know how depressing it is to be around sick people all the time, and they never seem to get any better. Alas, oh, Yorick. You know, there's an old cliche, says the speed kills. Well, it's not true. Nothing makes you feel any better when you're down. You want an upper?
No. Doctor. A card. I'm working as a private investigator. I'd like to know anything that you know about Oscar Cornell.
I can't tell you anything. Are you getting paid for this investigation?
Well, of course I'm being paid. It's on a week to week, but, naturally, yes. Yes, I'm being paid after...
You know perfectly well I am not allowed to divulge any information. Hippocratic oath. But if you're willing to split the fee with me, I could tell you anything you want to know.
Well, Doctor, I'd appreciate anything you could tell me. Now, as far as the economics are concerned, I'm sure that we can come to some agreement.
Jasmine Cornell is a dyke. She is in terrible condition. Her husband, Oscar, was frigid. How those two ever managed to live together for all those years as man and wife, I'll never know. I don't know what is going on. I'm lucky to make any dough at all in this dump. Everything I make goes for pills. For me. You don't think the doctors take pills, hmm? Well, let me tell you, the biggest amount of junkies in this country are doctors and loving that baby.
Tell me about Miss Fredericks.
Miss Fredericks is a drunk. She got to be a lush trying to get off the pills that I gave her. What's wrong with drugs, anyway? Drugs are good for you.
But what about Miss Fredericks?
Miss Fredericks is good for you, too, if you can keep her off the sauce. Pills are the only way out. Why, I have to take a pill every morning of my life just to get up. Why do you think I talk so fast? I'm so full of meth, I don't know where I'm at half the time.
Doctor, are you aware that Helen Fredericks was having an affair with Oscar?
Of course I'm aware of it. My women patients tell me everything. I always give my women patients a free feel just to let them know that I'm on their side. They can feel that I'm poking around, but they don't know what I'm looking for. Well, I am looking for a good time.
Doctor, in your opinion, is Helen Fredericks capable of murder?
No, doctors don't know everything, no.
But do you think that her feelings of rejection by Oscar could cause her to seek revenge?
In my opinion, no.
Why not?
She's a dyke.
But that's the same thing you said about Jasmine Cornell.
That's right.
Well, how can you be so sure?
Because I offered her a quickie, and they both turned me down.
Doc, did you ever treat Olivia Jessup?
The old man wouldn't let me anywhere near her. That is one weird family. I think the girl is a fruit.
Okay, Doc. Let's leave her out of this, shall we?
Well, the whole family is wacko. The old man, that little creep, Freddy. You're looking for a bad bunch. You don't have to go any further than that. Why, I removed an arrow from their colored man's leg only this morning.
Do you still have it?
Well, I don't think I removed the leg.
No. The arrow.
The arrow, oh, yes. I had no choice but to remove that.
Where is it?
Well, it's around here somewhere. I look there under the radiator, will you?
Thanks, Doc. Listen, can I keep this for a while?
Oh, yes, you can have it.
You've been a big help.
Oh, thank you, Malcolm. Malcolm, give my love to Ida May. And tell her to take potassium, and drink lots of liquids.
Liquids.
Hello, Dr. Simpson. Hmm? Malcolm has just been here asking a lot of questions. He has your arrow, Freddy.
Some sort. No, I'm terribly sorry about this, Malcolm, but I'm sure no real damage was done. I'll get everything cleaned up right away. It may just have been a prank by some kids.
What about Oscar?
Oh, I think we can safely rule him out.
My only solid piece of evidence, Oscar, was missing. If only I could have compared the two arrows, it might have opened things up for me. How did you get here?
I had to come.
Oscar's body?
I don't know Oscar's body.
It was hanging right there on that hook. Do you know who took it?
I don't like it here. Let's go for a ride.
Olivia, let's get this straight. I've been going for a ride all day, and this is where I get off.
You are something very special. You have a sensitivity that most men will never experience. I love you.
Drop it! Stand right where you are, Malcolm.
What is this?
We're taking you in.
And what's the charge?
Suspected kidnapping of Miss Jessup here.
I didn't bring Miss Jessup here.
I saw him take her out of our place under duress. She's undergoing psychiatric treatment by Dr. Simpson and has been confined to a quarters. This man's abduction of my highly unstable sister is a clear case of kidnapping.
Don't worry, Mr. Jessup. We'll get to the bottom of it.
Now, wait a minute, Chief. Don't you understand? This whole thing is a frame-up. I was getting too close to the truth, and I had to be stopped.
Well, after all, that's for me and Roy to decide among ourselves. Move out.
Take him, Roy. Don't walk out the door ahead of me.
So that's the way it ended. Seems like it was more than 7 hours ago when it all began. So now here I am, and Oscar's body is somewhere, and other than that, we're nowhere. But there's one thought that keeps hanging on. That one unresolved question that I just can't seem to shake. Who killed Oscar? The arrow hit Oscar chest high. The opening of the window came to a distance of 2 inches. Now, judging the puncture in Oscar's chest and the opening in the window, we come to a mean point of 3 feet 6 inches. But the only suspect that short is Freddie Jessup, who in fact is 4 feet 11 inches, which means that Freddie Jessup would have had to have been standing in a hole in order for the parabola of the arrow's trajectory to be accurate. I now could see that it was all fitting into a tight pattern.
You know, Roy, there's lots of usable junk here.
Well, you save everything.
Now, what did you throw this away for?
It's from last year's policeman's ball.
I remember we're going to have another one this year. Save the sign to change the date. Save it. The sign saved is the sign earned.
Hey, that no smoking sign is just isn't in here.
Damn it, Roy. That's my car.
You're under arrest.
I still am. Dr. Millon, you've got to help me find Oscar's body before the police catch up with me or I'm a goner.
Do you want me to hide somewhere?
No. What I want you to do is take that police car out there and ditch it back here. And when the chief comes, you stall him, okay?
I'll stall him.
Big Daddy? Malcolm. Well, sure, they had to let me go. The whole thing was a setup. Now, look, I can't talk now. Now, I want you to meet me on the Old Mill Road by the windbreak in exactly 30 minutes. I'll give you all your answers then.
Right,
including the proof I have on your daughter. And Big Daddy, come along.
Thank you.
was a piece of Oscar's jacket, all right. I could still smell the Purina. It seemed obvious that Oscar was buried somewhere in this field. But where? It was a big field. And I was running out of time. I was counting on Bert's dog. I knew he still had the nose for the job, if his heart was in it. There was only one way to find out.
Looking for something, creep? Okay, jerk. Drop the dog.
Okay, Winston. Go on home.
That's right. Now throw your gun over here.
Frame up didn't work, Freddy.
Worked good enough for you, stupid.
It's all over, Freddy. You see, you were too short to dig anything but a shallow grave for Oscar. You wanted to be a big man, Freddy. But your size gave you away.
Right there, Malcolm. You didn't really think I'd fall for that phone call, did you? Huh?
I thought you might.
We just let you play a hand out, creep.
He's coming with me.
Step aside, Freddy.
Look, Big Daddy. I know he's your only son, and he's a big disappointment to you. But he killed a man, and I'm taking him in.
No, you're not.
Big Daddy, I know you're rich and you're powerful. But I also know you believe in law and order. Without it, our society is destroyed. All our values, all those wars we fought for liberty, they'd all mean nothing. That's why Freddy's got to stand trial and then be sent up. So I'm asking you, as a decent citizen, to put down this shotgun.
Malcolm! Thank you.
Daddy. I think that's just about enough, huh?
Get up on our feet.
All right, Freddy, on your feet. Wake up, Ida Mae.
Malcolm? Malcolm, what are you doing home? What happened, What time is... Is it prime time? What happened to your face?
Nothing serious. Just a shooting incident.
A shooting incident? What kind of a shooting incident? Malcolm? Malcolm, will you please tell me what happened?
Ida Mae, don't ask questions. Just listen. Sure, it all started when Oscar walked into my office looking for help. At first, I thought it was an open and shut case of death, murder one. But it was more than that. Oscar was dead before he came into that room, because the dream in him was dead. What I'd been looking for all along, although I didn't know it, was a dream killer. I kept asking myself, what is the Manchu ego? Where can I find one? Is there really such a bird? Can I buy one? Did Oscar lose his? Did he really have one? And then it hit me, hot and heavy as a blowout. The Manchu ego was Oscar's dream. It's what he was searching for. And it's why he died. It was like that open-ended moment of immortality, that eclipse that sears the eyes, or that cloud that we reach for but seldom touch. It wasn't Freddy's arrow that short-circuited and finally broke Oscar's heart. It was this town, yeah, all of us, who sit in judgment of a man like Oscar. A man who has his own way of going about things, his own special vision. You don't have to understand the dream. You just have to mark it. No trespassing. It wasn't Freddy Jessup who killed Oscar this morning. We did it. All of us. We killed the Manchu Eagle.
Malcolm, I've known you a long time. But that is the biggest line of crap I've ever heard.
I knew you'd say something like that. You'd say anything at this point to save your pretty neck.
What are you talking about?
You see, Ida Mae, Freddy Jessup couldn't have killed Oscar alone. There had to be somebody else. Somebody who knew when Oscar was arriving. Someone who knew the location not only of my office, but of my client's chair. And besides that, somebody who knew where the hole was that Freddy could stand in. My guess is that we'll find chicken traces on your sunsuit and wedgies, tying you into that hole. The hole that you dug yourself.
What are you talking about? I think you're crazy.
Ida Mae.
What? What? What are you doing? Malcolm, what are you doing?
You're an accessory to murder, Ida Mae. I already have Mellon Swan's statement placing you at the chicken hole in the yard and listing a number of peculiar things you said to him.
Mellon? Mellon is senile. His testimony would never hold up in court.
Mellon is a doctor. Senility cannot be held against him.
Malcolm! Malcolm, I'm your wife! I love you!
Sure, you say that now. But when you're sitting in the gas chamber, you'll change your tune. They all do.
Malcolm!
Ida Mae, maybe they'll only give you 50 years. If they do, I'll be waiting for you. If I can wait around that long. If I can't, I'll never forget you. But we can both try.
Oh. Malcolm! Malcolm! Malcolm!
Did she
talk, Malcolm?
Not yet, but she will, believe me. Plenty.
All right, Roy, move it out.
I'll never forget her.
Forget who? Malcolm, which way is the interstate?
Just keep walking.